is Cinnamon Cooney, your Art Sherpa. Woohoo! We're live today for the Q&A for the Winter Sentinels, that really fun landscape we just posted on the mic. Today's my husband, John.
Hi, guys.
He's going to be reading your questions while I'm demoing some ideas that we covered in the lesson, and I'm going to drill down deeper into those. So for those of you that are really excited to do this, but you want some extra meaty bits to succeed, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the process and some of the whys decisions were made with the painting, and hopefully that might help you not only succeed at this painting, but maybe even look at photographs or references and think about them a little differently. Oh, I wish we had picture in picture today.
We can totally have picture in picture.
Can we totally have picture in picture?
Do you want
can we do the reference photo, or do you not have that one?
If you get it to, where's the reference photo?
Okay. Use the painting.
I can get you the reference photo. I have all sorts of
I don't know if I sent you the... I got to get my hair in. So the first thing I'm going to talk about while he's finding stuff that I'm going to open this up with is, if you notice over here, I've got a plate with some gesso on it. I have Liquitex Professional Gesso.
One second, I didn't know you were going over there.
This is what I actually have
there
out.
There you go. That's what you got.
Liquitex Professional Gesso. Couple of thoughts on gesso. Really hate the cheap stuff. Love Goldens, but my Golden gesso is in a giant gallon tub and not convenient for the show.
Right.
So this gesso, believe it or not, was something that I grabbed on a sale, because you know me, I believe in working my art supplies on a sale, and I got it so that I could do some what's called pop-up art shows. So it was just more portable than my, you know, it's just crazy to show up someplace with a gallon of gesso. But my favorite is Goldens. Things you might not know about gesso is that it can mold and have a crazy smell and get yellow and do odd things.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, you can contaminate your gesso. So, you know how everyone's like, do I thin with water and everything? If you get back into the bucket with a contaminated brush that has a bacteria or anything in it, it can actually cause all kinds of craziness in your gesso. I've never had that happen to me, but I have had that happen to many friends. So, side experientially, it's very true.
Oh, wow. That's crazy.
So, that's just some things you might not know about gesso, and those are some of my preferences. And why did we do the acrylic ground this way? I think acrylic grounds, we don't always do them on the show because I want to show you the different ways that you build a painting. But I really like acrylic grounds, and I really like acrylic grounds on landscapes. The issue with most acrylic grounds is that they underbind. In other words, somebody does like a wash or a stain, they thin the paint with some water and they put it on. And honestly, the properties of the acrylic paint are so damaged by that process that the following layers might not stick to the canvas. The proper ways to do an acrylic ground are to get like an airbrush medium, and that'll give you that watery effect but still give you adhesion. You can stain gesso like we did, right? Or you can even use like a glazing medium. If you just paint the canvas a color, it can be hard to sketch over it because it's just smooth. It's acrylic polymer. It resists things, you know. And so...
Oh, it's okay. Go ahead.
So that's just something that, you know, you've got to be thinking about. So I decided to go with gesso. I think gesso is our most friendly option in acrylic ground. I'm going to put some ultramarine blue here, and I'm going to mix it in with my palette knife, which you saw me do during the lesson. The reason I'm not as inclined always to mix it in with a brush, though I could mix it in with this brush, is that it's going to creep up the brush because there's so much media here. So I just like to mix it in with this. And then the next thing I want to talk about is why I used ultramarine blue.
Why
not orange or yellow, or how do I know what ground color to use? I get asked that question a lot.
Well, I'm sorry, I've been a little bit behind the gun here, but we have a whole bunch of people here in here. Like, we've got like 200 people, 130 likes, and they just keep coming to the room.
Thank you so much, guys.
And we've already got a bunch of questions coming in here.
Okay.
So, whenever you're ready for it.
I'll explain that one thing I just stated, and then we'll answer a question.
Yeah.
So I've got my ultramarine here, and you can see it goes right through the gesso, and it stains it. You can buy colored gesso, which is really beautiful stuff, but this is really doable to do as well. You can see the palette knife integrates it really well through the ground here. Sometimes you'll hear gesso be referred to as a ground. Anything that's called a ground in acrylic painting means the surface on which you are painting on.
Gotcha.
So we just being fancy, wipe off my knife. So the reason that I pick the blue, and what I'm going to suggest to you if you're painting on your own, is that if you pick a color harmony, right? So if you pick a color that's next to the color, the majority of the colors that you're working on the color wheel. So in this, we have like blues and kind of stuff that looks a little purple and whites and all these harmonious. So like harmonies are red, yellow, orange, or green, blue, purple. See, they're next to each other on the color wheel. If you pick a ground that's a harmony to your painting, then you don't have to worry about something unexpected. Like if I did a yellow ground on this, there's a good chance that the painting would have a green feel to it. If I did like a burnt umber ground under this, the painting might feel a little darker and muted over, you know, what I would want to have. So by just picking a harmony to the painting, you know, one of the colors that I'm using mixed into the gesso, I'm guaranteeing that I'm not going to lose that sort of simplistic monochromatic feel that this landscape has. Now, I'm using this, and I am full on in love with these. This is by Silver Brush. This is the stiff white nylon. They come in a pack. They're not expensive, and they are awesome. Just saying. The gesso is also nice as a ground because I'm going to be able to sketch right over the top of this.
Okay, so Steffi,
very easily.
This pertains to Steffi's question.
Oh, excellent! Yeah, okay. Answering any of your ground questions now.
Got lots of them. Okay. So she's like, "Why use gesso and not just paint it with color?"
Well, the reason that you use gesso and not just paint it with color is the acrylic paint is very smooth, and it does not take the marks nicely.
Gotcha.
Also, this gives you a nice tooth with which you could paint over.
Excellent.
And it's cheaper than using your paint.
It extends that quite a bit.
It extends quite a bit. So you're saving a lot of money. This is a lot of beautiful pigment, right? I didn't have to use very much ultramarine blue, and I didn't have to use any of my titanium white. And even though my titanium white is not expensive, it's still a lot more than the gesso.
Is there spray gesso?
I believe that there is a spray gesso.
Huh.
I don't know which companies. I'm going to guess off the top of my head, just given the nature of the companies, that Liquitex has a spray gesso because they really cater to street artists.
Gotcha.
Or feel like they do.
Huh. So let's see.
I don't know. The street artists always tell me that in confidence, but I think that that's their idea.
Huh.
Kind of edgier art. I'm painting my easel here, which is always really fun. And I love how the ultramarine always feels slightly purple because it's very close to the red on the color wheel.
Gotcha.
I'm going to have a sip of my little coconut lime soda here. Do we have any other ground questions?
So can you reuse a canvas that already has a painting on it?
You can. And reuse a canvas that has a painting on it. Absolutely. You can. If you haven't done a lot of treatments or media treatments and it is not even varnished yet, you can just either paint right over the top of it, as my mom loves to do, or you can gesso if you want to go back to a neutral ground, right? So those are your two choices. Like, if your painting has, like, a lot of dynamic colors and you're painting with student paints, it could be really hard to paint just on top of another painting.
Yeah.
Right? But if you're painting, like, and you would just want to gesso that so that you had a neutral starting point. But if I'm painting, like, golden paint,
yeah.
Let's be honest. If I'm painting golden paint, I get away with tons of craziness just because the product is good. I'm not a spokesperson in any way. Not in any way. I'm going to dry this so I can sketch on it.
Okay. So while she's doing that, I'm going to say thank you guys. There's like over 230 people here and over 186 likes. Thank you guys so much for coming by and giving us all the love. We really appreciate it. You know, and Simmons doesn't get to see the chat that's going on here right now, because if she does, she just likes to read it and then just read it, and then she doesn't actually talk back. So I take the chat away from her so I can read to her what's going on. And I really appreciate all the kind words and loving messages in there. I try to pass those along to the Sherpa during the show as much as I can, but definitely after the show. And I wanted to say just thank you, guys. I mean, like, really, Simmons and I have just had a fantastic time. Coming up with all the designs and stuff for you guys, thinking about what we're going to do next for you guys. And we just look forward to all the stuff we have to do. And I'll just tell them how much fun we've been having over the past few days, just coming up with all the new stuff and ideas for them. And
hope you're up for the holidays, because like, if you thought Halloween was a little drilled down, you're going to be like, let me out. Let me out. And it's okay. I actually had planned into January.
Okay.
So I can bring you back into spring and the melts and the thaws. Because by the end of winter, you're going to be like, okay, got it.
Ready for the
snowscapes. Got it. Good. Trees. Good. Lighting trees, flat on snow under sunsets. Yeah, I'm going to so cover you.
So Brianna is saying, why do a ground? I never knew this was done until I started watching you. What is a ground exactly?
Okay, so anything called a ground is the surface under which we paint for. A colored ground is when I create a color field on my canvas. And have you guys noticed that when you're painting on your canvas, there's pits? Oh. These little white spots.
Oh, yeah, where it doesn't suck up the mm-hmm. paint, or it kind of beads off or something.
We're painting heavy body paint. If we were painting fluid paints or soft body paints, we'd see less of that. Of course, we wouldn't be able to do our impastos or our painterly effects. That's really kind of a smooth kind of paint. So when you're painting a heavy body paint, if you do in a color ground, as you're painting, that color shows through the layers and creates a depth uh-huh. and finish to the painting, which makes it look way more professional and considered.
Okay. So
you don't always have to do it. You could do what's called an underpainting too, which is where you create a puzzle of the values, like the darkest values of a painting, and then paint highlights and you kind of piece that together too. But really what that is just a very complicated ground.
Okay.
And we do that too. Or you can just, you know, paint over that. Just try to paint all your canvas, you know.
So Fables asks.
Hi, Fables.
She says, I want to make gold gesso, but the website of my high-mid-range company, Transparent Gesso, says that you can add paint, but not how much paint.
Okay.
From your experience.
So here's the thing. On gold gesso, you've just stepped onto my big soapbox.
Woo!
All right. Daniel Smith used to make the most bombastic gold gesso anywhere. It was like crazy. They had some acrylic products. They're an incredible fine paint manufacturer. Everybody at that company is insanely cool. They really specialize in watercolors, but they had this gold mm-hmm. gesso, which like some of the finest artists in the world were into. Wow, was the stuff amazing. And then they quit making it. This is a little thing that happens to you as an artist, that you find a product that is so ideal and so perfect mm-hmm. that it just blows your mind. There's nothing we're ever going to be able to make. You need a paint factory to make what they made. I believe some companies are looking into okay. making a high metallic gold gesso. I'm really crossing my fingers that Golden does one.
Okay, so now
I'm going to answer how you're going to kind of flub it.
How can we make gold gesso?
How you're going to flub it is you're going to get Golden's gold paint. This paint has a high metallic refraction. It looks like the real thing. It looks like a gold leaf. You can mix it in to your gesso, and you're going to want to do at least a couple coats.
Gotcha. So how much paint should she add?
You know, you can add it. You could add the whole tube into your gesso. You're just not extending your paint very much then.
So you're tinting to your color.
Yeah, it's not like a retarder where you can put too much retarder to the paint. That can create a whole chaos. Or Flowade or many of those products where there's a 30% ratio. On gesso, I could have squeezed my whole tube of ultramarine into that little pop of gesso. I'd have gotten a little tooth from it. I'd have gotten a little tint from it, and it would have wasted a lot of my money. On the clear, what I'm going to say is that you're going to mix in, use your palette knife, go slowly, do a test, see how many coats it takes to get it, because I think what you're going to find is you're going to need a couple of coats to get the result you want. And really, there's no other than the gold metallic from Golden. I tried a lot of them. That one is like, if you want to see it in action, Angela Anderson on her replica of The Kiss used it. So you can really see how awesome it is.
Cool.
And I'm sure Lindsay's done a review.
So now hold on. If you don't have gesso, like if you don't have any gesso, can you just paint this blue on the background and keep doing this? Or do you need gesso to do this painting?
No, you're just going to struggle against the paint being very smooth. That's all.
Okay.
Just creates a struggle.
Okay.
But you can do it.
All right, cool. So
you can absolutely do it. Have done it. It's acrylic paint. Acrylic paint sticks to acrylic paint. So whenever I'm talking to you about a technique, it's because it makes life easier.
Mm.
And it's a way different artists might do things, because none of us do it all the same way. But you know, that doesn't mean that you can't just be like, you know what? I got none of this Indian yellow. I got some cad yellow and some, you know, bird sienna, and I'm going to... It just, you might not get the exact result I get. Whenever you change a color, you might not get the exact result I get. It doesn't mean your painting is going to explode. Your canvas isn't going to be on fire. Just be a slightly different color. And I'm not going to go tell your friends that you didn't paint it the exact same color as mine. That's not happening. Oh. So you're pretty safe.
I have a question. Gail's got a great question.
Okay.
Is it true that gesso is harder on our brushes than regular paint is?
Yes, it is. Absolutely true. And it is true that your canvases damage your brushes.
Oh, so they just wear on them.
It's because Because
they're wear items.
They are. Your canvases absolutely damage your brushes. So we paint in expensive canvases, right? But those canvases have too much of a tooth. They're not finished. And that can wear your brushes down. Now, if you're painting a really inexpensive brush, that's not as big of a deal. But, like, say I'm painting... This isn't... Actually, that's not expensive. These aren't really that expensive. But say I'm painting a well-manufactured brush. So this is a silver by... this is Ruby Satin. This is, like... Seriously. I have been testing all the silver products lately, and John, verify how long have they been in water? Don't tell the silver company.
So what I will say is that longer than they should. Like not on days, but I mean, like, we're going beyond we
above the feral soaking. Not one has popped. None have lost their shapes. I haven't taken any of my brushes back to the spa.
I have seen crazing on it, but they haven't.
Not on these.
No.
No.
Huh.
No. You can go through them. Oh, okay. Not a craze, not a thing, not a thing. And I haven't had to take them to the spot. They are holding up.
That is the impressive part about the tip.
Yeah.
But, all right, yeah.
Yeah. So. And these things are holding. They're not losing their shape. It's really amazing. And so, like, they're not crazy expensive. Like, I think one of these retail at Texas Art is, don't quote me on this, like around $15. Right? When you think the junk that's 20 at Michael's, that's just not even... Like, there's... Sorry, Michael's. Did I say that out loud?
It's... No.
Anywho.
I think that there's a lack of selection there.
Okay. So there's very... So I've had to buy them and had feelings about that, where it was like, this brush is $22.
Well,
I want to kill somebody.
Okay. Well,
anyhow,
let's talk about
this
that,
is,
though.
Huh? No,
let's talk about it. That's legitimate. You go...
Am I allowed to talk about that?
Yeah. You go to the store. We bought a $22 brush. We won't say
so
the name of the brand
of
the brush. We did buy it from a major retail store, and the frustrating part was the brush was, I mean, it wasn't even as good as the Simply Simmons brushes that we tell people to get.
But you got to remember, the Simply Simmons at Michael's are the multimedia, so if you're painting heavy body paint, they're not the extra
they're
firm
not there.
Filaments.
So,
and the issue with the Simply Simmons, besides some real like difficulty getting them in, is these will crack if you leave them in water, and they do wear out. But they're also like...
$4.
$3 to $4. So you're like, I now understand in my own studio, in my real life, when I'm painting, this is my brush.
Gotcha.
Right? This is, you know, these brushes are my brushes, but, and now my brushes have copper ferrules, because did you know this was a thing? can you see how coppery it is? Maybe here.
Yeah, we can definitely see how copper, you got a thing for copper ferrules.
I really do. I don't need this brush. This is a bristle hair. This is almost stiff enough to do fan stuff in acrylic, but not quite. All right,
okay.
I'm sketching something in.
You're sketching things in. I'll keep asking questions.
So one of the things that I want to tell everybody, right, as I'm sketching in landscape painting, right? In landscape painting, you paint the furthest thing from you first. So if you're looking at a reference photo, what's the farthest away thing from you? It is space. It is the sky. It is that atmosphere. That is the first layer that you would paint. Then what comes next? It's whatever cloud event is happening. Then what's the next furthest object? It's a mountain. And then what's the next furthest object? Maybe it's a closer mountain. Then you got a hill. Then you got a shadow and some grass and then a tree. And so when you're trying to decide the order you're painting something in, look at what is far away and start there. And that's not... There's no absolute rules in art, but this is just a good starting place.
Okay.
If I may say so, myself.
So there's like so many questions. Okay. So many questions.
I'm going to just do this up top here real quick.
So real quick, Carol was asking, do you know the difference between Mod Podge, glue with baking soda, marble dust, and commercial gesso?
The differences between all of them?
Yeah.
Yes, and they're not the same products at all.
Now, don't we have a quest that kind of goes into some of that?
We have not done that quest yet. Let me just start out by saying Mod Podge.
Yeah.
Is a fantastic company. The Mod Podge company is fantastic. I love everybody there. They're an incredible help desk. They have a variety of products, and it's fantastic for what it's intended for. It is not a varnish ever.
Uh-huh.
Ever. It should not be used in place of soft gel.
Mm-hmm.
Because what it is it gets tacky if it gets wet again, like PVA glue. You should be using PVA glue in your paint. It's susceptible to moisture.
Yeah, and those are experimental. Well, if you were doing experimental art, then that's okay to have experimental projects. But yeah,
just in general, no.
We generally suggest following the manufacturer's recommendations on not using additives that are not designed for your paint. Because you get unpredictable results.
And you really do.
As a student, you really should look for predictable results. This helps you learn because you want the same result every time you do something. And that's why we recommend using higher quality products when you're a student.
But you got to respect your budget.
But you got to respect your budget. Absolutely. We're looking for those consistent behaviors of a product so you know what you're going to be getting.
Yeah, that's why I love sales, man. I just got all my golden paint on sale recently. So, and I got a bunch of Liquitex paint on sale. And they were cleaning it out. And I said, yes, please. Yes. Now, I'm switching to Indian Yellow.
You have to tell them where that hand brush came from because everyone's asking about that hand brush.
Okay. These fan brushes are like insane.
What's that one called?
And no, I'm actually reserving this. No, okay. Silver and Princeton both have fan brushes. Okay. That when there is a Princeton.
Gotcha. Okay.
So what I'll say is I go into Texas Art Supply and they put out new displays and I'm very susceptible to what's happening there.
Mm-hmm.
It really gets me. So something else we're going to talk about from today's project, and I want to talk about all these things when I'm teaching these, but sometimes it makes the lessons 2 hours. So this is nice to be able to do this on occasion so that you guys understand some of the why we're doing. All right, gotcha. Got some titanium white. And what do I have here? In this particular case, let's show some transparent mixing white. Now, I don't tell you the whole story of white because honestly, if I told you the whole story of white, it would freak you guys out so much you'd probably quit painting.
Oh, man. I know. I was reading over your shoulder on that.
So what I'm going to say is for the purposes of acrylic paint, you have titanium white, zinc white, mixing white, unbleached titanium, and titanium buff. Very quickly, what's the difference? Titanium white is a high tinting strength, high opacity white that's a recent invention and is incredible on your palette. It really, really lightens stuff, but it can over-mute your colors. Zinc and mixing white. Sometimes mixing white is zinc white, and how you find that out is by checking the pigment code PW4 on the back. If it's PW4, then it's zinc. If it's got some other mixture, it may be titanium white and zinc, and that's a company by company issue. Zinc white is kind of controversial in oils because it's probably why those paintings cracked. However, for the purposes of acrylic painting, that doesn't probably apply to us because there's so many flexibility agents in acrylic paint.
And the binder is flexible.
Yeah. So we don't have any paintings old enough to know if they're going to crack because paintings need to be crazy old before they start to crack. So probably we think they probably won't crack, probably. People who get PhDs in art conservancy think it probably won't crack.
Good.
That's the best guess that I can give you. Now, the controversy of titanium buff versus unbleached titanium. Because art's got so much controversy. You ready for this?
Okay, I'm ready.
Right. Okay. So there's a very famous story about Mark Golden in the bar. Not Mark, his dad. Chris
yes.
Golden.
Okay.
And is that,
I'm not sure if it's
not Chris. No, Sam think, Golden.
That sounds right.
I'm having a brain fart. You look that up and verify that, and I'm going to have a moment. Thank you, Intertube, okay. To tell me, and I'm sure I'll hear from the Golden Company. I'm really sorry. Anyways, he had a barn, and he made paint, and something crazy happened. You can read this article on Just Paint. It's so fascinating. Anyways, he ended up with this off-white paint instead of titanium white. And I don't know. People just loved it. They just full-on loved it, and they used it. And then the other paint companies got super jealous, and then they started adding some raw sienna to titanium white to kind of make it. But what they made in the barn is not raw sienna and titanium white. It's actually a different chemical composition and has a different luminosity and is a very different product.
Mm-hmm.
Controversy.
It is, Sam. It is.
Thank them. Goodness gracious. I just... So, okay. Why do we have these two? Because we know that our titanium white, right, is likely to, has so much pigment and so much load that it's likely, right? Uh-huh. You can see this is much lighter on my finger. It's likely to overload a color, but it's useful where we need it. What do we have at the horizon line? We always have a lighter color, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. We have 265 people here and 265 likes, Cinnamon. They are just out here
loving
it. Thank
you so much for enjoying this day. I'm going to come over to my titanium white, right? And I want to really, really have it be light. If I want to say that this is a cool, cool day, right? I'm going to want at my mountain ridge here the lightest color. Look how gorgeous that is against the ultramarine, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
Now, why use ultramarine against Phthalo Blue on such a simple palette? Why not use all Phthalo Blue, right? Or all ultramarine?
Mm-hmm.
So when I looked at this piece, I noticed the values, the difference between the cools and the warms in the composition. And the sky is infinitely better with a little bit of Phthalo Blue. In fact, I would make an addition to the lesson and say, if you wanted to do the entire sky, and I'm going to demo what that would look like in Phthalo Blue instead of doing some of it in ultramarine, that is okay. If you are in, say, India and you cannot get Phthalo Blue,
mm-hmm.
you could probably use cobalt, I think. Maybe indigo. I got to look at my thing. For sure you can use Prussian. Let's just be a little darker. So I'm just doing this coming up here. See how that just pops against that? Isn't that just beautiful, the contrast between these two?
Oh, yeah.
I really, 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 did I say that strongly enough?
Really?
Want this to be as light as possible against the mountain.
How really?
Really, really. I love my glazing medium. You know I do. I'm so excited about that stuff. You guys are why I found that, because I've never been in such a hot, dry studio that I had to have glazing medium to get through painting. But now I am. I'm going to just pull some pure Phthalo, and I'll come do the top up here. I'll put this up. Because what I'm going to do is I'm just going to talk about a couple of the techniques and a couple of the whys so that you guys, if you're doing these, not only can really, really complete the tutorial we just put up, but also so that you can maybe go find another photograph that's close and see if you can apply these skills. That's the goal, right?
Yeah.
So I'm just making sure it's very dark up here. And then as I'm going down, I'll definitely add a little white into that and get my glazing medium. I love my glazing medium. I love it. It's so nice to me. I'm going to paint around my little sun that I kind of put here. Obviously, the sun's not that big, but that's the area of light that I'm going to put in. So this is a very good way to tell a story of a very kind of like bright, sunny day in mm-hmm. the mountains, right? If it wasn't sunny, I might have done it all in ultramarine.
Huh.
You know, I might have done it in just black and white and a little bit of color.
Yeah, it's an unusual color combination to use.
Is it?
I don't know. It seems like those color, you know, the ultramarine and the... I don't know, what do I know? I don't paint, but I mean, I don't see those colors together, I guess.
There's a lot of choices that we have in snowscapes. Usually snowscapes are a simple palette, right? They're a very simplified palette, but, you know, unless you get into those sunrises or sunsets, which we're going to get into, and then you get pinks and oranges and golds across the snow. That's coming up later, you know. Has anyone noticed that there's live paintings scheduled in the future?
Oh, yeah.
And those are live paintings. All the upcoming scheduled ones are fully live paintings.
Now, this is a canvas board with blue gesso on it.
This is a canvas board with blue gesso on it.
And now the reason why you're painting the things farthest away from you first.
Farthest away from me first.
But you're not painting over the that you're not just painting the entire area because you want to leave that blue space down there for the mountains.
Well, this is where I'm going to have this. And believe it or not, because these paints are transparent, the light goes through them and hits the canvas board and comes back and they impact each other. I have to tell you, on this main camera, this does not look like it is. Main camera's color adjustment's way off.
It looks... from here, I don't know.
Just letting you know.
I think it may be the
monitor
you're in
front
of.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, thank goodness.
So
I'm going to just go ahead and just momentarily just maybe put this a little bit, not take out all the purple, but because what happens is that blue and yellow make green and yellow and purple make gray, and I want some bright sunlight. I've got to lighten it so I have some clarity there. Now, we're going to talk about light sources.
Okay.
Okay? So my light source is theoretically here.
Yeah.
Right? Which means my mountains in the distance, obviously my sun is not this big. This is just some light.
Right.
The mountains are going to be hit on this clear, clear day with the light. And so this side of the face is going to have some light. Then you'd also have to have some areas that would have a shadow cast on them. You might see some light right here, but this would be in shadow. Even if you don't have a reference, there's some things that you kind of know.
Would you do me, can we squeeze a little wish in there since you're about to paint that mountain in?
Yeah.
Kim just threw up a wish here for us, and I'm going to go ahead and throw these in here. Well wishes for all those who are sick or dealing with migraines and health issues.
Oh, thank you. I've been missing the wishes.
Yeah, so let's throw some wishes in there. I know we got those. And I know that we've had some tummy issues for a couple of our community members, so I'm going to put some love in there for them. I think I saw that we have a happy birthday for our own Jay coming up, so let's go ahead and throw that up
happy
in there.
Happy birthday, Jay. We have a little girl who is in remission right now.
Oh, we're
putting super. I like to hear about her. She needs some sleep though, so we're gonna wish that she's getting some sleep.
And we can put some gratis in there too.
Huh?
We can put some gracious, some thank you, some love back to the universe of saying thank you for the good treatment.
Thank you for the algorithm not messing with us anymore.
And for the health and for the remission and for all of our community.
Thank you for our community. We're okay. Things are starting to normalize, which is why you see stuff. Not that we won't. I think this has value. I also want to do one where you guys send me paintings and I talk about how you could improve those paintings.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, we have Jack Skeleton coming up as Jack Skeleton Claws.
Yes.
I think you're going to be really surprised the place I'm going to take it. I'm going to be showing you some cool, easy bokeh with that.
Yes.
That's a no-fail bokeh. And then we've got, obviously, Elsa from Frozen.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like Ren and Stimpy took it.
Oh,
so
yeah.
So I am going to do a Ren and Stimpy Christmas scene.
Ooh.
Can't help it.
That'll be
and
awesome.
Then we have that surprise Sunday funday of Flame Gremlin's birthday.
Oh,
black
yeah.
Light butterflies.
Well,
so
I'm
excited about all those things.
You know, before you get back to painting, I'm just going to go ahead and look over here, and I'm just going to tell
just
you.
Hanging out today, talking art, fixing our art. We're doing an art clinic today. Welcome to Art Clinic.
You're going to have to start getting up there to dance because we've got 299
no
likes.
Way! There's 299. We like to paint.
And I want to show you something.
As a community, we want to paint.
Can I show you something really cool?
I'm going to do the Roxbury. Well, I'm going to do the Roxbury Ballet because, like, I haven't been stretching out lately, and I'm afraid if I do the full Roxbury, I put my neck out.
I'm going to say thank you because we have almost a full house in here. Like I said, we got 282 people with us.
That is amazing. And we're going to get back to our regular kit.
Yeah.
There's just going to be a lot of art. Sorry if you guys don't like notifications.
We are Sherpa because we have over 300 people here in the room. And Alan pointed this out. We've got this beautiful little number. Look at this over there.
Wow.
88,808. And I'm pretty sure we're going to have that 88,888 all the way across here.
Are we going to watch for that?
I'm going to keep
an
eye on it.
I think we have to do a special something when it's all eights, don't we?
I think I'll come give you a big kiss.
What's the angel number? Somebody, can you Google what the angel meaning of all eights is? Like 8888?
That's awesome.
Some of y'all know what I'm talking about.
It's just good. So.
Just admit it. Just admit you look up the angel numbers. You could put that there until it turns.
Well, I'll bring it back up there.
Okay.
But I just wanted to say, you know, I love you guys. Thank you for coming and hanging out with us, you know. And don't forget, if you're at home and you can't get up and dance, to wiggle your fingers and wiggle your toes so that you can remember to tell your body that you're alive. And that's
you're
what
alive.
Dancing's for.
That is what you dance for.
So we, you know, love you guys. Love having you here. Thanks for celebrating with us. And we just think it's awesome. Crazy eights. A lot of numbers. They're awesome.
They are. I like aligned numbers. I feel like the universe is talking to me.
It's a line of crazy eights, and that's just all of us.
I have tinted my white, the titanium white, with just a hint of the ultramarine. And I'm going to come along this hillside, and I'm going to imagine a little ridge. And I'm going to pull that. Now, in the painting, I had a reference, so I wasn't imagining a ridge. There was an actual factual ridge. But if you were, say, painting this, like, from your imagination, you would have to assume that this mountain would have shape, wouldn't you?
As opposed to being flat?
Yeah.
And that would be Texas.
And that would be Texas. So see how I'm just creating shape there? I don't have to worry about things because the blue is, like, coming back, and I can even come right here and put some shape here. Then I can come into my ultramarine blue. This is a very powerful, ultramarine is the most incredible powerful shadow mountain color. We will be doing a bunch this summer when we're trying to say any kind of hot clear day where there's some sort of reflection on the mountain. This is how we're going to be trying to say it. We don't want it to be too full strength because it would feel a little too close. Because the brighter a color is, the closer it's going to feel, right? But look at that. Look, mountain. Poof. It happened.
Ha. So Mary looked up what the angel number was.
Thank you, Mary.
So she says, your angels are telling you of achievement, success, striving forward, progress, and attainment. So that's
Thank
awesome.
Thank you, angels. If you guys could pretty please be in charge of the algorithm for a little while, I would. No, it's actually, listen, in all seriousness, it's, you know, it's a fine thing. And what happens is they make adjustments to make the system work better. And during that time, you just wake up one day and you're down 500 subscribers and you have no views.
Cinnamon's
and that's
all,
very stressful.
Cinnamon's very, very focused on her relationship with the machine right now.
I'm a little bit, but I do recognize that's me and that's not the system, and that's fine. I just had a moment.
I like seeing the...
I get a little Chicken Little on occasion, which, so it's very good that I paint, because I think if I didn't paint, I would not be an okay person.
Now, I won't say that I subscribe to a whole lot of superstitions, but what I do, I'm definitely a watcher of the universe. I'm on vacation. I'm here to see what's going on and to do it. So I love seeing when numbers line up and when things line up and those magical things kind of come together, because it's incredible and it doesn't happen often. And what we're doing here together is pretty magical and awesome. I'm, you know, always excited and just sort of in awe to be part of it.
I'm going to do this time. I'm going to do Indian yellow and the zinc white.
Yeah.
On this one. Last time I did titanium white and cad yellow, but I felt like the cad might be a little overpowering to the scape.
Mm-hmm.
Just a feeling that I had. Sometimes you'll do a piece, you'll sit with it, you'll ponder it, and you'll be like, man, I have this other feeling that I have, you know, and then you're like, and this may not be it. So this is like, you get to see me sort of work some things out. It's not that I won't ever get into the titanium, because I just did. Look at me. I just went.
Just got some titanium.
And I'll just add a little of that there. But you can just see it's just a much more powerful kind of thing. But I want to get that feeling of that bright light in the sky.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to just keep blending and working it. You can even blend it out further using your glazing medium. Man, this stuff just will get you through. I do like it. I don't recommend products unless... I have a lot of products that you guys never hear about because I don't like them.
Hmm.
And I don't feel good about recommending them to anybody.
So when are we going to do a Houston meetup? I've seen this pop up.
All right. So we have seriously looked at this. Like, seriously, seriously, we've looked at this. We have some tentative plans. We have to get some venues to agree.
Mm-hmm.
We want to make sure that it's real easy and plausible for everybody. And we want to make sure that everybody gets something out of it. So we're thinking spring. Mm. We wanted to do it this fall, and then just it got crazy.
It's Christmas is right here.
So we're like, okay, let's do it in spring. What will happen is that on the website, thearchherpa.com, thearchherpa.com, there will be, anytime we leave something, this whole thing could crash, and I wouldn't even know it. I'd just be talking to the camera. We're going to start posting it on the website. We're going to start talking about it. And we're just, the idea is, look, I don't want to do this unless I can paint with you guys. right? I mean, I will have a part of the meetup that you could just come and give a hug and greet, but we want to do something where you paint with us. We're just trying to figure out, like, how that gets set up, what the logistics of that are, because I think, like, for us to be together, the most exciting thing would be to paint together. Like, and I'd like to do those regularly. Like, I think once we get the first one off, like, successfully, then follow-up meetups will go better. But I want to, I know we're going to have one in June, at the end of June, in, where's VidCon? Anaheim. 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 We're going to be in Anaheim. We're going to have a meetup and a paint in there for sure. Mm-hmm. That's June. That's happening.
Okay.
Sometime in spring, we're going to have a meetup. Are we going to do the one in Utah?
Sure.
Yeah. So there's going to be one there. And then we'd like to do one here in Houston. And so for sure there's three next year that we've got kind of coming up that we're trying to really for real, not just talking, schedule. One here in Houston. You know, something like maybe we paint together a Texas art supply and take an art safari through and then go all eat at Bobby Yaga's or something like that. That's sort of the thought process.
And we're going to have one also on the East Coast because we're going to do something in the New York greater vicinity area.
That one we have the least worked out.
Yeah. But
we do want to do an East Coast one. Just because we also want to go back to the space over there. We love the space over there. So those are the three locations that there is serious plotting
mm-hmm.
going on, you know. And two of them is because we already have tickets to go to those locations. So right. It's like super doable. So you're not like, and we have some stuff coming up to help create those and fund those and make those happen.
Mm-hmm.
So those are for real going on, not like just talking, like for real.
Yeah, and I really like that. I want to do something in New York or the greater New York area, maybe Boston. Ooh, we could go down and do something down by Chris with Boston.
There you go. I'd like to go see Chris
and
play some games. Okay, I'm going to draw in my tree trunk now.
Tree trunk.
Because the tree trunk will help me kind of figure out where the heck I might possibly be putting my shadow in this scape. Because I've kind of zoomed in. This is real similar to what we're doing. All right. So I'm going to just do one little tree. And I guess I'll put this little tree right here. I'm going to just draw my little line up. I'm going to take it up to about there. How's that sound? Okay. That's really wonderful, right?
Sure.
Once I know where that little tree is, then I can be like, definitely have to have some kind of shadow under that sucker.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And maybe back here, now that I'm looking at it, I want a little tree line.
You do?
I do.
Whatever crazy thing.
I'm going to get this. This is a natural bristle. So here's the thing about natural bristles. Many of you guys will go to the art store and they'll feel like they pass the stiffness test, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
Because they seem very stiff. But as bristles get wet, they get softer, guys.
Oh.
So natural. It's sort of, the cake is a little bit of a lie. And I'm just using the burnt sienna and the ultramarine. Now, I put out way too much paint.
So
I do that for the palette, though.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so?
No, I'm just curious. So natural bristle brushes, are they strong or soft?
Dry, before you get any moisture on them. They're quite stiff. Once you get them wet, they start to really soften up.
Interesting. So that's good to know.
Yeah. Might make you feel like, man, I'm following the rules. I listen to the instructions. And I'm still having issues. That's all it is. The brush thing, I'm really right now in the middle of working on the brush thing. You know, we know what we've got, what we like.
Yeah.
But I have dreams.
Yeah, it's the, you know, it's like. Yeah, more so on that soon.
Real soon.
So,
but you know, we've been on quests.
You're just dabbling in a little bit of trees.
Dabbling in a little bit of trees. I just felt like on these Q&As, it's like when we paint along, I wonder if anyone's painting along today.
There's a lot of folks who really enjoy having, you know, some paint along with us, even if we're not, you know, and they've also commented they really like having those pre-produced ones so that they can, you know, it's real detailed lessons there. So this may be a good hybrid where we can.
Yeah, I don't think we'll discontinue this completely.
Oh, no. We'll definitely be doing some more full big paintings up here.
And then we'll like meet up for like, oh, let's cover some of the concepts, like especially if we're doing anything weird, new or hard.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to make a slightly darker color of this. And I feel like I need some maybe distant little trees here.
Now, Vamp Angel would like to know.
That's a good location for a tree, though.
Cinnamon, do you ever use a scruffy brush?
I do use a scruffy brush. Oh. Many scruffy brushes. Scruffy brushes have great value.
She has a bucket of scruffy brushes.
Yeah. Can't have enough scruffy brushes.
I've never seen her throw away a brush.
Okay.
Yeah, I can
so
see
I'm
that.
I'm going to just take a little of this shadow out this way, some dark shadow.
We have some sticks.
So we have some different kind of little areas here, right?
Yeah.
This one is closest because it's biggest. Let's put in some highlights in our mountain. Let's get out our number 8 bright, and we're going to highlight with our snow color, which is a little bit of the ultramarine and the white, right? And we're going to say, oh, there should probably be some highlight here.
So Panda wants to know, should acrylic brushes be better soft or better hard?
It depends on the type of acrylic you paint with. If you're painting with a soft-bodied paint, like,
fluid paint.
Fluid paints. Anything that's like fluid, high flow.
Dyes. Multimedia stuff.
Yeah. Well,
you know, like your FW
soft
dyes.
Brush.
Your FW dyes.
Yeah.
Inks.
Definitely softer brush is better. If you're painting with heavy body pro paint, dude, you need a brush with some strength to it.
Yeah, definitely need firm filaments. Because they've got to be able to move that thick paint around without, you know.
Yeah.
And what's interesting, you know, is that.
I'm just adding some brighter white to the space to imply that this maybe is higher. Where you have it be brighter is where it's going to imply that there's like a hill or some shape. See how that just creates an implication of shape. Haven't really done anything there. I've just made it feel like there might be ridges. Right?
Yeah.
Come here and add a little bit maybe here.
But, you know, there's more too. And later on, I'm sure... I'm very confident we're going to be doing a brush quest that's going to talk about like
how we need to update and redo the brush quest.
Yeah, where we talk about some functional things. But what I'll say is that there's a lot more to brushes than just how firm they are or the shape of them, because the hairs, the filaments, the complexity of how the did you know that an artificial filaments that they use actually mimic real hair. So they have a tip that's different than the shaft, that's different than the base.
Mm-hmm.
So that they, you know, it's not just a cut piece of plastic.
So what it is for you in why you're looking for it, like this brush, it would be a very soft brush. I could put makeup on it. And then this brush has a nice firm filament. It's actually got a little sizing in it because I was like resizing it. I'll get one that doesn't have sizing. I'll get this one. Okay. So what this brush, these are both brights, right?
Mm-hmm.
This one is going to over-pull water into the brush, right? So when you want a watercolor brush, you want that watercolor brush to pull in a perfect amount of water and then to dispense it in a predictable rate on the paper. Because the worst thing that would happen is you pull in a gunk of water and then it just all over your paper. Like it just throws up all over your paper. It ruins your painting, right? But a watercolor brush is not going to be stiff enough to move heavy-bodied paint. It's going to oversaturate the paint with water. And it's going to create a hot mess in acrylic paint, even though it's perfectly engineered for watercolor. A multimedia brush, which is like the kind of brush you might use in craft paints and stuff, is going to pull in the right amount of water for that media. This brush is designed to pull in moisture, pull whole paint. A lot of times I can do a palette knife technique with these because they can roll a bead on the edge. These are made to perform for the media they're created for.
Right.
And bristles are fantastic for oils.
Yeah.
So I've got really quite a bit of kit right here. This is a really big deal brush I'm just kind of rolling out here. That I'm going to put my little tree in with it.
All right. Let me come up here and see what you're doing.
So the thing about your trees, I always like to do a little kind of furtive dab at the top. Right? Where the tree has had a little kind of growth up. And I'm going to create my tree shape. Now... You know, what happens to these pines in nature, right, for sure, is that weather impacts them, right? And they don't have perfectly even shapes. Some of the branches are facing me. Some of the branches are growing out. They definitely don't do this little back and forth thing.
Mm-hmm.
They're very, very particular. And getting a sense of how to build... Whether it's from reference or it's from your imagination, a tree that has that sort of tree feeling, that's a very important thing to be able to do. I like to start with a dark base, right? And it's like down here. You know it's going to be dark down here, don't you? Because it's under the tree. Going to be dark under the tree.
Yeah.
Has to be. I'm going to use some glaze to sort of blend that dark out.
You go down there. Oh, I'm not even on the camera.
Sorry. I was just glazing, blending it out, and I'm going to head back up here. So when I'm painting this tree, you've heard me talk in lessons about telling the story of the tree, and I'm wondering, does that make sense to everybody? Does everyone just think I've lost my mind when I'm talking to my painting? Or do you guys go, oh, I need to tell the story in my painting?
I'm pretty sure that, you know, like, I don't know. I hear you doing it all the time, so I think it's kind of normal.
Because the idea is that when I'm painting this tree, if I have a story about how it grew here, if in my mind I'm world building its experience on this mountain, like this one is a lone tree, right? These guys are real far away. You'll notice that I am kind of brushing these little branches down. That's because for sure snow is heavy. And so if this tree has had snow on it over winters, right, if it's been going through that, its little branches are going to get weighted.
They love hearing your story. Barb says, tell the story, Cinnamon.
Right? So this little guy, he's sort of in a beautiful patch of sunlight. He doesn't have a lot of competition for food or resources. But he is alone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, on his little pot on the mountain. Maybe he's hoping that a seed picks up next to him. You know, is he a sad tree? Is he a happy tree? Is he, like some trees, man, they don't want companion trees. They don't really like the other trees. They want to just be by themselves.
This is just the story that you like to make up to tell about your painting.
I think when we have narratives in our painting, I'm going to bring a little branch out here. It allows us to create a sense of space that the viewer, even when we're not there, I really, really hate. One of my pet peeves is when an artist has to stand next to their painting and explain to you why it's good. I mean, like, you can't just go up and have an experience with the painting. It requires like a dissertation and a monologue that's a lecture that's 45 minutes to get to why this creative thing has any meaning. It's just like, it to me.
Let's frame that. We're talking about high-end art galleries. This is where your professional artists
are
working.
You know what? Sometimes I've seen some blue bonnet people do this too.
Well, I mean, but you know, it you don't really need to justify your work when you're doing, you know, like fairs and things. But when you're in a gallery and your stuff is hanging there, you should not have to stand there next to it to.
That doesn't mean that I don't want to know the creative process, right, or the creative history of the work, because I totally do. And I'm really interested in the creative process. But I should be able to engage the work sans the gallery owner, sans the artist, just me and this piece. Do I connect to it organically?
Does it?
Because art is sort of an orphan. At some point, it's mommy or daddy is going to cross the rainbow bridge and not be there to be there for it, kind of like Van Gogh. And the art has to go out into the world and fend for itself.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of sad. I have been saying that my whole life, but now I'm thinking about it. I'm like, it's kind of sad. It's the orphan. But it kind of is. Now I'm all turning. I got to stop being such a goof.
So we're putting some more leaves on the tree.
So you can see I'm using this round brush. Now, I used a bright before, but I'm showing you how you can do it with a round brush. Because a lot of times I'll say, listen, guys, it's not the brush.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the brush. It's the artist. But a little bit, that's true. No. And by the way, I just really love this brush. Just telling y'all right now.
I like the color.
I do. I love these. I just would have buckets and buckets of them.
So now I'm going to jump around here a little bit, because Gail was asking about, you know, when we do our event, she was concerned about, you know, what accommodations and what things are going to be there.
We are too.
Yeah, we are too. And what I'll say is that we're already coordinating with some local hotels and things, and we're going to have a variety of them for you guys to work with. None of them are going to be set. You're going to be able to, you know, talk to them all, but we have multiple price points so that everyone will be able to.
We're going to try to make it kind of not problematic.
Yeah, very. You know, we're going to make it as easy for you guys to do as possible. So.
You know, and then you could also, you don't have to like be in like some like our deal. You could like do your own deal.
Yeah, 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 absolutely. We're just trying to, and none of this is like, we're not actually going to, we're just trying to make it easy for you guys.
We just want to pull it off, get together, and paint together.
Yeah.
For, I mean, like many, many of you are just ready to paint in person. You're just like at that space. And I want to have that experience, you know, with you guys.
We want to have a big party where we all get up to dance at 300.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
And, like, can you imagine, like, a room full of people playing art game?
Yeah. That would be fun. Yeah. Like, stuff like that. We want to have just, like, a day or 2 days of really coordinated stuff, a lot of kind of spiritual art connectivity stuff where we're, like, you know, connecting together. And
yeah. Being us.
I'm going to paint the back tree. You see that back tree?
I see the back tree.
I'm going to take some. See how I'm mixing this color into the white? Uh-huh. A lot of people just want to go white with their snow. White should be used very infrequently in snow. I'm going to just put some snow on this slightly closer tree. See how I'm doing that?
Yeah.
This is a different painting than we did in the thing. So if you showed up today, you got a surprise.
It's surprise.
Surprise, surprise, surprise. Sorry. Sometimes I go Gomer Pyle. It's a whole thing. So I'm going to pull my color out. I'm going to load it into my white. If I need a little glazing medium to keep it drying out, I'm going to get it. I'm going to come here. Now, things that you're going to decide. The snow will be slightly heavier, oftentimes on one side of a tree, as will the light. Obviously, because if the sun's here, where's the light going to be? It's going to be coming here through these branches. The deepest part of the shadow is going to be like right here. So the snow here is going to be quite dark. It's only going to be light where the light can actually hit it. But that doesn't mean that this won't have a highlight on it. It will. And I'm just using the tip of my brush. And you'll notice that I'm creating kind of like this little lumpy shape space. Lumpy space princess. Lumpy space princess. And I'm just showing you another way to do this background light. That's different than the one where it's like in a starburst through the tree.
You know who's here having a coffee break with you right now?
Who's here?
Miss Lindsay.
Hi, Miss Virgo Crafter. I have to tell you, I really liked your deer.
Oh, yeah.
I don't really think that's like one of my favorite paintings of the YouTube holiday season, man. You just dropped the hammer on that. I was like, I saw that. I was like,
that was,
I
want to
put that on every, I mean, if Hallmark doesn't like pay you a bunch of money and put that on a card, I don't really, and that's actually a compliment. Because mm-hmm. It's really just the most holiday,
awesome.
Holiday painting. What? Where did that come from?
She says she's all snowed in up there in Maine.
Oh, is that what, she was just like, I'm like this little tucked in deer?
Yep.
It's cute.
Awesome. Art high fives on that one.
Just coming along.
And so if you guys don't know who we're talking about, that's Lindsay the Frugal Crafter.
We're just talking to our friends like that.
It's like, oops. Oh, yeah. I got to tell them. So Lindsay the Frugal Crafter has another art channel, and you can go over and check her out. And she has, I don't know, like 1,300.
More than that now. She's like, every time you say it, she has like 100 more videos.
Yeah, like thousands.
So you guys that are writing me saying that I have too many videos and there's too many notifications, go subscribe to Lindsay Basis for Comparison.
Is like awesome. And every day there's a new project out there. Go check her out. We'll make sure there's a link in the description or something. Yeah.
She doesn't come by for this. We just like to explain who she is because otherwise it just like, seems like we lost our minds.
Context.
Yeah. Context of our crazy.
Yes.
Oh, I love all the holiday projects right now mm-hmm. on YouTube. We do a lot of fun stuff, you know, on the platform all year. But I think starting fall, I'm going to bring a branch straight down. See that?
Oh, yeah.
That's how I bring a branch facing me, is I bring a little line of the white paint. See, I like to be able to slow down. Like, on the less, man, we cook it. We did that in an hour, man.
Yeah, well, we wanted to make sure that you guys got some, had some really drilled down time, because we know that sometimes when we get to talk in here during these live events, we can meander a bit, a touch.
Talk to our friends.
Yeah, talk about the deer, you know.
There's a really good deer, though. Good deer. Seriously, we all need to be talking about the deer.
Yeah.
Really like the deer. I was like, I had such a little heart Bambi, happy every holiday ever moment about that particular painting. It just,
What deer? Steffi Cakes is like, what deer? The deer that Lindsay the Frugal Crafter made that we're all talking about. That we're
yeah,
going to put a
she
link
did this
in.
Painting, this watercolor painting of a little deer, a little baby deer, a snuggered in the snow with little holly branches. And I'm just seriously, it was like if you took a pot and poured in all the Christmas spirit that you had and all the Christmas joy and a healthy dose of loving Mother Nature and you just stir it all together and pour it out on a painting. That's what it was. I was just like, it's a squee painting. Now you go, yeah. It was, so I had some feels about it. John heard me have it, so he can authentically say, and I don't know, I'm going to tell you one of my best kept personal secrets, one of my great treasures online. There's a digital artist named Jackie Lawson, and she has these digital cards that are animated, and they have this incredible art. It always reminds me of, you know, a Rockwell piece and kind of like that. And the deer hit that same spot in my heart as my Jackie Lawson cards. Sorry.
Hold on. Look up. Here, I got it for you.
There it is. How'd you get it?
I found her thumbnail. It's,
did you?
That's a lower resolution one.
That's a low resolution, but come on.
It's awesome. It's like, I was like, whoa, that's
holiday.
Cool. I'm going to find a better one for it. But definitely need to go check her out. It's a really great
There's this, like, I want to do, like, a new segment where I paint along with my favorite YouTubers.
Oh, my gosh.
And talk about what that experience is like, just, like, what it's like for you. And that was one of the ones I wanted to do. I'm going to have, like, rules, like, I can't paint in my own media or some such nonsense.
Missed it. What? Just the 88888.
I missed it?
We just see it's up there on the little thing. But that's, isn't that awesome? Thank you, guys. I just wanted to say, I'm going to come over and give Cinnamon a kiss to celebrate that.
Okay. I can wait painting a couple bits of snow. Thank you. It's been a thing. I told Lindsay about my algorithm times. I actually told everybody because I was like running around with a little bag.
I have to say thank you to all of our friends who provided moral support during our mild.
Oh, I have such thank you. You couldn't thank Chris Plays Games enough. And, you know, DeFranco was even helpful because he was like, sometimes YouTube breaks. Don't worry about it, man. He didn't tell me that specifically. He just said that to his whole community and I was watching, but it felt like he was talking to me. We'll see if he is talking to me at VidCon, right?
I have a secret support network of friends that make sure I don't cry at night when YouTube breaks.
Yeah.
I go and they console me and say, no, it's okay. Don't worry. Remember, machine learning works this way.
Machine learning. All right, so now all I have to do to make this tree feel a little more tree-like is to get a slightly lighter gray right here.
Okay.
And I'm going to come. I don't want this to be too light for these behind-the-scene ones because, right, the light isn't on them. I mean, there's sunlight, so they would have some value changes, but it would be minor. For these branches, right?
Mm-hmm.
These behind us, because where's the sun coming from? Just always ask yourself, where's my sun? Where's it at? We're going to do a fun thing where I'll show you how to actually use 1-point and 2-point perspective to figure out where your shadow is. If you're just, you know, I know my perspective classes are awkward, but I like doing them anyway.
I like your perspective classes. I like watching them.
Well, some people are just seamless about how they explain them. And then there's me going, this is hard, but I hang in.
And, you know, we haven't done any Little Brush shout outs in a while. So I'm going to say our high fives to Emma.
Hi, Emma. Oh, and the Crafty Twins.
And the Crafty Twins.
Who are probably wandering. Oh, wait, no, they're probably back at school. But hi, Crafty Twins.
And I saw Emmy the Mastermind here the other day.
Hi, Emmy the Mastermind.
So Art, high fives
and
to all
Brooke.
You guys. And Brooke, yep. And
There is
Skyler?
Oh my gosh, it's killing me because I just saw a painting by a little boy. He did a Batman and it was so good and he was 8 and then I hate when the name escapes me. If you're his mommy, if you're the mommy of that little brush, you know
Xander?
Who I'm talking about, 8 years old and did a incredible Batman.
Oh,
we were chatting
that.
In the chat.
Yes.
We were chatting.
And Little Brush Xander's here.
Hi Xander.
So man. Our high fives to all our little brushes. We love seeing you guys coming and hanging out.
Wait, I hate when I have like that moment.
It's a human brain moment. We're going to get more of the kids, that all of the little brush shout outs in here for sure. So.
Yeah, it's fun stuff. I like Gale it. You know, we're going to have some, because we got Ren and Stimpy coming up. Ren and Stimpy one. We have Jack. We have Elsa. I think I've got to get a Grinch in there sometime.
Jalen?
Yes.
Jalen.
Yes. Hi, Jalen.
Thank you, community.
Really good Batman. Really good. So, coming up, if you check the schedule, we got Jack the Pumpkin King in his kind of Christmas gear, and dude is going to be, I don't know, if you're kind of like a little edgy, little kind of like counterculture or whatever, you're going to really like what I do here. Again, there'll be some cool Easy Boca, some stuff. And then we're doing, of course, we got to do Elsa. We got to let it go for the snow. I thought about Moana, but we're still working out how to teach that quickly enough. And then we've got Ren and Stimpy from A Christmas Scene. And then I somewhere in there, I think I got to do a Grinch. All right. So I have this Indian yellow, which you could do. You could do Cad Deep. You could do Australian Sienna. Bunch of stuff that you could do here, guys.
Yeah.
I like this one, but you could do another thing. And no, not made with buffalo urine anymore. All right, I'm going to put a couple little spots of this gold light on the tree right here. See that? On my snow. I think those things are important. Don't you?
Oh,
and
yeah.
And I'm using my zinc here so that it doesn't overwhelm my yellow. Well, I guess that's mixing white. You know, same thing. It's PW4. I've told you everything you need to know about white paint for acrylic right now anyways. I won't tell you the rest of the stuff. A lot of the stuff about white paint really is for oil artists. They have a whole different thing. You know. And they paint with lead paint, so I don't even really know what anybody's talking about, like worries or dangers. Because lead paint, you know, that'd be real. I'm going to just put a little here. And then maybe we'll little bank there coming down. Okay, so we did that. That's kind of those basic techniques that we were covering in this. This is an alternate way. If you didn't want to do the starburst, you didn't have to do the starburst. It's another way of doing it. Mm-hmm. If you want to knock that back, like I'm feeling like maybe I could knock it back a little bit, I'm going to take some of my zinc or mixing white, and I'm going to just come here and just push this back with my white paint a titch. See?
Ooh.
Just pushing it back. Just push it back. Do what you've got to do. Do what you got to do. This is art.
Ooh, another little brush, Dana.
Hi, Dana.
How you doing? And Paige.
Hi, Paige.
And maybe Jordan? I'm not sure if Jordan's a little brush or a big brush, but hi, Jordan.
So I think this one here was more like in the 2-hoot range.
This, yeah. This,
yeah.
It's kind of nice.
I might put it up as a thumbnail, and we'll just say it's a companion piece.
Yeah, it's a... It's something.
But hopefully this explanation made some of those techniques just feel a little more mellow and maybe explained why we did the things we did. In landscaping, we're going to be doing colored grounds. So gesso's good to get. And again, while I'm not a fan of basics gesso, that doesn't mean that you can't get it.
Right.
Right? Because you're like, you have to get the best art materials your budget allows and just remember to work those sales. Like there's some sales going on right now. Right now in Craftsies, there's a sale. Right now in Jerry's Autorama, there's a sale. Sales going on Michaels and Hobby Lobby and all over the world. But there's a sale happening at your art store.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, get good at the couponing. I do. I work it. I work it because I got to get copper ferrule brushes. I just like them so much. There's probably actually a real benefit. In general, in art, they don't make something just to, like, make it.
Mm-hmm.
There's a reason for it. I'm going to find out the reason actually tonight. Gotcha. Is when I'm going to learn the reason for the copper ferrules, and I will report it back to you. If you have brush questions of any kind, if you could go drop those at TheArtSherpa.com. There's a blog that was like, ask your brush questions here, and it's got a brush joke cartoon. Any brush questions about acrylic brushes that you have, we want to do an omnibus, a brush omnibus.
Yes.
If you guys ever watched Ask a Ninja, you're like, oh, I'm thinking of tying a shirt over my face an art ninja, but John's like, but I'm like,
yeah, you really like, do it. So yeah, there's all sorts of questions coming in. Like,
you're like my gem of power.
But yeah, I think this is like good questions, Gail. Like, we can answer a couple of these real quick.
Yeah,
but,
sure.
Copper ferrules, will they turn green after being in water?
No, I have really put that stuff in water.
What
I've
is
got a couple of them and has not turned anything.
Why do you like copper ferrules?
It's pretty.
And is copper?
I have to find the art reason why they're on there.
And
but I think they're so pretty.
I can tell you that. So, and can you tell the difference between copper? Is copper ferrule a brand?
No. It's a type of metal that's used in the fabrication. So, okay, real quick rundown.
Show them what the ferrule is.
This metal part here is the ferrule. This part is the bristle. This is the handle. This is a long-handled brush. This is a short-handled brush. When I say I don't like long-handled brushes, I mean the ones that are out to here, because I don't want to poke myself in the eye. But most, you'll know when you run into one of those, you're like, that's uncomfortably long. This is long-handled. This is double crimped. I don't know if I have any single crimped. Do I have single crimped?
Not anymore. I think we got rid of most of them.
Yeah. So there's just some different. Oh, here's another copper ferrule.
Yeah, the copper ferrule. So originally.
Look at this thing. Look at this.
The reason that the copper.
I have a bunch of these. Sorry.
No.
Just like them.
It used to be that.
It's a really good brush, too.
Brushes were made with, you know, the metal that's on there has to not corrode. And so a long time ago.
And also I think people have metal allergies to some of the metals.
Well, yeah, if you just go back a long, long time ago in a galaxy far, far away when humans didn't have access to machine-made stainless steel.
Yeah.
Copper, bronze, and brass were cheap, inexpensive materials that didn't corrode. So brushes were made with those materials. Mm-hmm. And because they polish up and they look nice, that's how. So historically you would see more brushes that had copper or brass or bronze. But now. Chrome and aluminum is cheaper and it doesn't corrode, so they use those in manufacturing. So it's just about, again, the brushes are a big deal. There's like so much craziness to it. Like she talked about single crimp versus double crimp, the glue that's used.
This is stuff, keep this in a fun space in your heart though. Don't get like overwhelmed, like if I don't have this brush, I can't paint. One of my very favorite artists on the planet draws with a Bic pen, like straight up a Bic pen.
Yeah.
You know, so don't ever let it be like a material shaming thing where you feel like you got to have this, you got to have that. You get to have those things. They're out there in the market. If you catch a sale or it's in budget, you get a chance to upgrade, definitely do. First paint you should upgrade is your white. You should get titanium white from a pro brand. I recommend Golden.
Yeah.
It's my favorite white. You know, but it doesn't mean that you couldn't do a great painting with what you have. So never let that stress you out.
Oh, look at little brush Kiki. Hi, little brush Kiki. So just wanted to say thank you. I want to make sure that I stop and say thank you again. I know I said this a lot, but man, I've just been feeling so grateful for you guys. You know, it's been so much fun doing this stuff and seeing you guys out here with us. And I'm just trying to try to go over and see, you know, where even we're at right now. Because I think that we've had just a ton of people here with us today. And I've lost my screen. I don't even know where it's at. They're out here somewhere. You know, we love seeing you guys.
Thank you so much. And Thursday, John's dropping a much requested video that makes a quest we did earlier work.
Oh, yeah. We've got, okay.
That's the hint. A much requested video that makes a quest we did earlier work. So you can do the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I've changed the thumbnail of the quest to its finished result. So the new tutorial has that first part, which of course you could just do on your own. And I'm going to try to add a fall finish to it this week.
Even though
it's not fall anymore, I don't care. I just want to add a fall finish to it, so we have two choices.
Now, Barb was asking, did the original painting from this live come from you as well? Did you just,
Oh, did I just make this up?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the other
but
one?
But based on the other one. The other one was from a reference photo, and it was like on the thumbnail of this painting.
Cool. Okay.
On this thing.
Yeah. That was the one that we just did earlier. Okay. So,
like this is the matching pair, right? Like this is the pair.
So you could
pair these up.
We didn't mean to do that. That just kind of happened.
That just kind of happened because we just wanted to talk about some stuff. And this is kind of like a two hoot. It's a little simpler, not as much stuff going on, but that's okay.
So I
think it's a really nice piece. I'm gonna take a photograph and we just like it's a thumbnail and it is what it is.
There's some good guessers in the chat. Guessing what's coming up
next.
You
probably know.
They're like, oh, is it? And they're just like, oh, I'm not, you guys have to show up.
For people, and wow, we're coming up to the end of, pretty soon, of that painting.
Uh-huh.
So someone's going to win that painting, and I think my next wild painting is going to be Pepe. And, yeah, so door.
Yep. Oh.
I am not allowed to be in charge of anything for Christmas, and now you know why.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm a flippity-gibbet.
Yep.
All the time. But I'm loving the holidays, and I'm loving spending time with you. And, oh, you get to meet somebody new that's joining our family soon.
Ah.
Not a baby.
That's true.
No, no. Baby with fur.
Baby with fur. So there's, you know, you've got, I'm just going to say, you got 250 people out of 383 likes. We love having you guys. Love doing this. And you're going to see more. Like, probably some more stuff here very, very soon dropping on the channel.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of, I don't know what else to say, stuff that I can't even mention.
I'll put this picture on the blog so you guys can use it as a reference if you decide to paint this one instead of the bigger one. Mm-hmm. And I'll put this reference, the overall reference photo. I'll put a little blog up with everything, and then I'll catch the Barnes thing, too.
Yeah. So. All right. Well, we love you guys. I'm going to go ahead. We're just going to say goodbye because we will just sit here and hang out with you if
you guys have a wonderful, wonderful week. And we will see you Saturday for Jack.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Love you guys.
Bye-bye.